Well, good morning, and thanks so much for joining us at St. Andrews Online. We're so glad that whether you're an old friend who've been with us for a long time or whether you are just joining us for the very first time, we're so glad that you've joined us, and we pray that God will speak to your heart today. Today we have the special privilege of having a couple guests. The service you're about to see was recorded last Sunday and is part of our series of 100th anniversary special Sundays. We have Sean Allison and his mom, Pat, as special guests with us. Sean was a teenager in the congregation when his father, John, was the minister, and Pat was very involved in the ministry through her years at St. Andrews as well. We're going to begin with Pat sharing some words, just some words of encouragement from John chapter 17, and then we're going to hear the call to worship and go on with the service from there. And we're going to hear Sean reflect on, especially through his work with Wycliffe Bible Translators, what it means to hide God's word in our hearts and just the importance of God's word to us. So let's prepare our hearts now to receive God's word as we hear from Pat first and then as we hear from the praise team and the call to worship as we are led now into this time of worship. May God bless you as we worship together.
I feel led this morning to start with prayer. But the prayer that I'd like to start with is Jesus' unanswered prayer from John 17. So if you would join your hearts with me, I believe in the Holy Spirit. Let's see what he says here in John 17. This is the message, by the way. And this is a word to us, by the way. It says, I'm praying not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me because of them and their witness about me. The goal is for all of them to become one mind and one heart. Just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, so they might not be one mind and one heart with us. Then the world might believe that you, in fact, sent me. The same glory you gave me, I gave them, so they'll be in as unified and together as we are, I in them, Holy Spirit, and you in me. Then they'll be mature in their oneness and give the godless world evidence that you sent me and love them in the same way that you loved me. We want to thank you, Jesus, that you continue to pray this prayer through the ages, that we would be one with you as you and the Father are one. We pray that you would answer this prayer even today as you unify our hearts and our minds together in you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Our reading today is from Psalm 119, 9 to 16. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes, as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word.
You stood before creation, eternity in your head. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failures and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders. My soul now to stand.
Failures, Lord, fill my life. Thank you.
lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And a light unto my path. You're the light unto my path.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come again to praise, worship, and adore you. We are very fortunate that we can gather to praise you and for the opportunity to participate in in-person worship services again, while others of the congregation can use modern technology to watch the service at home later. We all lift up our praise and worship to you. In your word, we read that where two or three are gathered together in your name, you are in the midst of us, midst of them. Be amidst of us as we turn to you at this time of worshiping you with all our hearts and minds, as has been done within this congregation for many past generations. And in particular, open our ears to hear your word and open our hearts to receive it as it is brought to us through your servant, John Allison, on this and other special anniversary celebration service. And we pray that the praises of your people will continue long into the future. Lord, we come asking forgiveness for our past sins. Yes, none of us are perfect and righteous. Lord, as we come before you, we confess our commissions and omissions as we have sinned against you. For the things we have said or done, and for the things not that we ought not to have said or done, but remain silent or inactive, forgive us. In your word we read, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And there is none righteous, no, not one. Hear us now as we pause to confess and seek your forgiveness. Lord, we also come with thanks and appreciation for all that you have provided for us. As I said before, we thank you for this opportunity to use modern technology to meet in person or virtually. We thank you for our families and extended families. We give thanks for those in the congregation who stay connected with their brothers and sisters while here at St. Andrews, whether by making phone calls or making personal visits or dropping off goodie packages, particularly during this recent time of the pandemic. We give thanks to the country in which we dwell, although there may be some things that occur and for which we do not agree or appreciate, like freezing winters or toasty summers. We are truly fortunate to live in a peaceful country. When we look around the world and we hear of wars and rumors of wars, Lord, we think of the situation in Ukraine. We think of those who have lost loved ones through death and the destruction being brought upon that country. We think of those who have had to flee their country, leaving loved family members behind. Oh Lord, we ask for your intervention that peace may soon return to that country again through the negotiations of their leaders and other world leaders. Around the world, we see people fighting and protesting on the streets against their government, with lives being lost. And over the past week, we have seen and heard of the tragic situations of mass murders in the United States, where families are mourning the loss of loved ones particularly of children and grandchildren. We give thanks for those in leadership and in government here in Canada, whether it be federal, provincial, or municipal, Lord. Lord, we here in Ontario are going through a provincial election culminating this Thursday. Lord, we ask that the members elected maybe of your choosing and your leading. Lord, we give you thanks for the exceptional circumstances we have in Canada. Lord, we also give you thanks for all that you have given to us and provided for us, our homes, our families, our food, our safety. Hear our thanks, O Lord, for you are good. We thank you for your everlasting love, which has continued through generations past and to continue for generations to come. Lord, we now intercede for those in our congregation and for those missions and missionaries here in Toronto, across Canada, and around the world, which we support financially and through prayer. We lift up to you those working with the homeless and less fortunate at Scott Mission, Yonge Street Mission, Evangel Hall, and the Out of the Cold program here in Toronto. We lift up our two St. Andrews theological students, Bran Jung and Abner Dean. Having completed their studies and prepare for the next step on the road to which you are calling them. We think of Brian as he seeks a call to serve as a minister or pastor within a congregation, and of Abner as he becomes ordained as an elder within this congregation next week. We lift up to you Peter Brown as he returns to Canada after serving several congregations in and around Paris, France. And last but not least, we uphold Sean Allison as he heads off to return to and continue Bible translation work he started many years ago for the Katoka people in the Cameroons. Be with him as he journeys to and from the African continent, and as he renews his relationship with his colleague Charlie in the translation work. We know that you are the one and only true God. It was you who made us, and we claim you as Abba Father through the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and it's in his mighty name we pray. Amen.
Saying earlier when I got to church, I have only one thing to do in service today, so I was feeling a little lost. But here's my one thing, so it's my chance to shine. The two Seans get to have a bit of a conversation. Every time, Sean, we've had a guest here for one of our anniversary Sundays, just take a moment and I ask about three or four questions. Some people here remember you, but they remember you when your hair was not quite so gray, and maybe even you weren't quite as tall, things like that. So they might want to be reminded of not just who you were, but who you are and what you're doing now. And there are those here who didn't know you from back in the day, and so it's just a chance for people to get to know you and what you're up to. So, my first question, as always, is just simply this. Who is Sean Allison?
Sure, I've actually got a picture there. That's not the picture. This is the picture. So this is a picture of my family, just so you can sort of see who's there. So my oldest son, Josiah, on the far left, is married to Tessa, who's beside him. He's in law school in Calgary, finished up his second year this past month. My second son, Nate, this is a picture of his wedding last year, got married to Ella. He's looking to do his MCAT in June and hoping to get into medical school at UBC. Pretty tough to get in there. My third son, Drew, is sandwiched between the two of them. He's in grade 11 and quite interested in writing and theater and arts. He and my daughter Annie just put on a performance of Mary Poppins with their homeschool group. They finished last night. And my wife Lezlie, she homeschooled our kids for most of their time at home. She continues to homeschool our two youngest, and both of us teach at Trinity Western University. But we'll get to that here in a second.
Wow, that's a beautiful, beautiful picture. Weddings are wonderful for that, aren't they? Put on our best faces. But that's a beautiful family. Thank you for that, and thank you for being here with us today. So you were with. So tell us what was and has been your connection with St. Andrews through the years, and is there anything that kind of stands out in your mind from back in the day or through the years about that connection?
Yeah. So when we were in high school, my twin sister Bonnie and I, my parents moved here to Toronto. My dad, John Allison, was the pastor of St. Ace for a number of years. I always call my my sister by my daughter's name. Bonnie and I went to Etobicoke Ecclesia Institute. And during our time here at St. Ace, I took a summer missions trip to Honduras. With teen missions, and that really transformed my life. It was because of that the Lord called me into Bible translation.
Wow. And so, but there's been a connection ongoing over the last number of years as well. There's been a
yes.
I guess we call you and other people like you mission partners.
That's
because
right.
Because you're in mission and in various places, not necessarily in congregations, but through financial givings, we like to partner with you and,
yes.
and pray for you.
Yes, St. Andrews has supported us from the very beginning of our ministry time, so all the way back in the mid-90s, St. Andrews has been a partner with us through the years and has faithfully been praying and supporting for us, and we are always encouraged to come back, get a chance to see people we recognize and new people in the congregation. It's exciting to be here this morning.
So what are you, I don't want to, you may be getting into this in your message a little bit, and I don't want to, decide what you need to say now. But, so what are you doing now exactly? What is the mission that we are partnering with you in?
Yeah, so our assignment is with Wycliffe Bible Translators, and we have two roles. The current role that we have during the school year is that my wife and I teach at Wycliffe's training center called the Canada Institute of Linguistics, CANIL, which is on the Trinity Western campus. So Lezlie teaches ethnography, and I teach grammar courses. And then in the summertime, I work with a mother tongue translator from the Kodoko. It's a Muslim people group, but this man whose name is Charlie, that we call Charlie, he and I work together. So 2019 was the last time I was there. 2020, 21, obviously COVID, couldn't make the trip. And so I'll be going back again in June and July. And we'll be working on the Gospel of Luke. There's a mission agency that wants to make the Jesus film available to the Kodoko people. And so we're going to be focusing in on Luke now.
Great, that's great. So, as you think about, yeah, we've been through 2 years of pandemic and just whatever other issues and whatnot face the church and the world today. Is there a word of encouragement or advice that you would want to give, maybe to St. Andrews in particular, or just to the church in general? What word of encouragement or advice would you give?
First of all, I want to thank you. Thank you for your many faithful years of supporting our mission work. Also want to thank you because you took a risk on some guy who was in high school and sent him on a summer mission trip, and that transformed my life. And so I encourage you that when you have these youth that have gone to the youth program now, but to encourage them to take these opportunities for summer mission trips and to begin to broaden their view of the world and to see the kind of work that they could be involved in worldwide. And I also want to just encourage you to be faithful to God and to His Word. We actually had a passage that I was going to read here for you that was mentioned in the prayer from Matthew 24. Matthew 24, and I'll just read a bit of it. Jesus answered, "Watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes, tornadoes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So let me encourage you to persevere in the faith, to stand firm to the end."
Amen. Thank you. Listen, why don't I just want to take a moment and pray for you, not just as you preach, but for your ministry, your family, and everything. So why don't you join with me in prayer as I lead in prayer now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise. Just how that moment a number of years ago now, when Sean was sent on a mission trip, went on a mission trip with the support of his church here at St. Andrews, and just how you used that to not just point him in a certain direction, but to shape a life and a calling. So, Lord, we give you thanks for that. We give you thanks for the faithful people of St. Andrews who ministered to Sean at that time and through the years. Lord, I pray your blessing upon Sean and upon his growing family, Lord, that they will be drawn together in love and in mission as they move forward into things like medical school and the end of high school. Lord, we pray for his children, his wife, and his entire family. Lord, may your blessing be strongly upon them. And Lord, now as in a few moments as Sean preaches and brings your word to us, Lord, I pray that you would speak through him. And speak through him and Charlie as they do their work in the Kodiakal language. Lord, may your word just go forth to all people. So, Lord, for all of this and so much more, we give you thanks, we give you praise, and we seek your blessing for your sake and for the sake of your kingdom. And it's in Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
So it is great to be with you here this morning. I might have to click forward to... let me just begin with a brief word of prayer. It's Psalm 19 and verse 14. Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So I'd like to share three stories with you this morning. The first one has to do with a little bit of myself. The second one is a story of Billy. The third one's a story of Tommy. So first then, some of my own story. As I mentioned, I took that summer missions trip to Honduras between my grade 12 and grade 13 year, back when there was a grade 13. I don't know if they still have it here in Ontario, but that was back in the day. To help prepare for the trip to Honduras, we went through a boot camp training in Florida at Teen Missions headquarters. And during the weekends, we would get a chance to meet with mission agencies, with missionaries from different organizations. And on one of those weekends, I sat in on a presentation by a Wycliffe Bible translator. And he was sharing about the value of the Word of God and the impact that the Word of God, the eternal Word of God, could have on eternal souls. And as I sat there and listened, it was like God tapped me on the shoulder and he said, "That's what I want you to do." And that transformed my life. That changed what it was I intended to do with the life that the Lord had given me. Another thing that changed my life during that summer was actually this little packet of verses that you have pictured there. It's slowly disintegrating. It's fallen into two pieces now. But we were given a group of verses, and we would learn different verses each day of the time that we were there. And so it's probably a little bit too small for you to see that, but the categories were things like salvation and assurance, fellowship, God's will, obedience, faith, prayer, consecration, love, temptation, work, and witnessing. And so we had groups of verses addressing these different areas of our lives. And these verses and other verses that I've learned over the years have been really formative in developing who I am in Christ and who I am becoming. So I just want to share with you as part of my story some of these verses. Acts 4:12 is one of the verses that addresses salvation. There is salvation in no one else but Jesus, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we may be saved. A popular position to hold in society today is to say that all religions lead to God. And Acts 4:12 addresses that perspective head on. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we may be saved. Another verse that speaks to that issue is also John 14 and verse 6, which Jesus is speaking, saying, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Our culture takes offense at those words because Christ is making an exclusive claim, the claim that he is the only means by which we may stand righteous before a holy God. How is it possible that we could stand righteous before a holy God? The Bible can be summarized in four words: creation, fall, redemption, recreation. The beginning of the Bible makes it clear that God is the creator of the universe, and humankind was made in the image of God. And in the beginning, we walked with God in harmony. We had a relationship with him. Nothing stood between us. But in short time, the fall occurred. We chose to disobey God. And a wall of sin separated us from our holy God. But God chose to redeem us. Though we deserve death for our sins, God's Son willingly chose to die a death in our place and to give us the righteousness that he had so that we could once again stand before a holy God. A verse that clearly portrays that is 2 Corinthians 5:22. God made Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. But crucially, Christ didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead, thereby conquering death for us. And that was the first step of the recreation. We now await the completed recreation, our own resurrection, and the unveiling of the new heaven and the new earth. One of the verses that addresses the issue of obedience is 1 Timothy 4:12. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. When I learned that verse, I was a young guy of 18. I'm not so young anymore. But whatever age we are, we can be examples to other believers in these different areas of our lives, in our speech, in what we say, and what we choose not to say, and what we post or tweet, what we choose not to post or tweet. We can be examples to our brothers and sisters in our conduct, how we behave day in and day out, week in and week out, year in and year out, because we know that the Christian faith is a marathon, it's not a sprint. And we can be examples in love to our fellow believers and for non-believers as well. We can be examples in how we hold to our faith in Christ, persevering to the end, as I read from Matthew 24 earlier. And we can be examples of purity, purity in what we allow our eyes to see, what we allow our minds to think, where we allow our feet to go, and what we allow our hands to do. Under the topic of faith, Romans 10:17 was one that we learned. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Notice how that verse is structured. It doesn't say directly, faith comes by hearing the word of God. It says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. And that reflects the original Greek. Get myself caught up here for you. That affects the structure of the original Greek. Because of that, we need to be very sensitive to what it is that we hear, because faith comes by hearing. We need to be careful what we listen to, what we watch. We need to be careful what we read, because we have a tendency to believe what we hear, whether it's true or not. So in order to hear truth, Paul's advice to us is that we make hearing God's word a priority in our lives. That way our faith will be grounded in the truth of God's word. Faith comes by hearing, so let's be sure to hear and listen to God's word. One of the verses that addressed love was 1 John 4:7 and 8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love is of God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Love should be that distinctive feature of the Christian life, as my mom was reading this morning from John 15 or 17. Both as individuals and as the body of believers, we should be recognized by our love. It actually serves as a testimony to those outside the church. John 13, 35 says that everyone will know that we are Christians by the love we have for each other. When we treat each other with love, it shows that we've been born of God. Another way that the Bible talks about that is about our being new creations in Christ. And a verse that presents that idea is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. As new creations, we live lives guided by the Spirit of God in us, the very Spirit that lives in Jesus. Jesus was known to associate with tax collectors and sinners, as we're told in the Gospel of Mark, Mark 2:15-17. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Jesus wasn't afraid to befriend those people that the religious people of his day wouldn't get near to. We can ask ourselves the question, who are the people today that the religious people don't want to associate with? Those are the ones that we should befriend. Those are the ones that we should be sharing Jesus' love with. Remember that everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. And then one of the verses on temptation was 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to humankind. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation will also provide a way of escape that you may be able to endure it. When I was younger, this verse particularly addressed the issue of sexual sin, but it also has relevance to many areas of our lives, like the temptation to walk away from Christ and his claim of being the only way to the Father. That's a temptation that's common in the church today. We probably each have people in our lives that we love and cherish who have chosen to walk away from the Christian faith. God has given us his word as a way to escape the temptation of walking away from him so that we can remain faithful to Christ in our current social context. But we need to make use of that way of escape. To do that, we need God's word to dwell richly in our lives, as we're told in Colossians 3:16-17. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So there are some of the verses that have been transformative in my own life, and that's some of my own story. Let me now share with you the story of Billy. Billy was a young man who served as a missionary to his own people. His family were cloth traders, and they were comparatively wealthy. Foreign missionaries had previously come to Billy's language group, and some churches had been established there. The Bible was available in the official language of the country, and Billy was one of the fortunate ones of his people group because he had received a relatively good education, and he could read and he could write in the official language of the country. He was able to read the Bible in that language, and he became persuaded that God's word needed to be made available into his mother tongue as well. That way, everyone could read it, and not just those who'd been able to get an education. He felt that if they could all read God's word for themselves in their own language, it would have a great impact on the entire language group, and it would protect the people from being swayed by false teachings that were influencing the people in the churches. Billy therefore set to work at translating the New Testament. Unfortunately, word of what he planned to do spread to the more influential people of the church community, and they were concerned that such a translation would strip them of their important social status. They discussed the issue with the chief of the tribe, and they were able to convince him to establish a law which made it taboo to translate the Bible into their language. Because Billy had already begun the work and was wanting to continue it, he had to leave his country in order to have the work advance. He completed the translation of the Gospel of Matthew, and he decided to get copies of it back to his own people so they could read at least portions of Scripture. The prominent people of the church in his own country heard what he was planning to do, so they sent men out to capture Billy and to confiscate what he had copied. Billy got wind of their plan, was able to escape to another village in that country, leaving behind many of the copies. And to his regret, most of the copies of Matthew were destroyed by his adversaries. Despite the setback, he continued to translate, and eventually he had small pocket-sized copies of the New Testament ready. He wanted to get those copies back to his people group in his country, but since he wasn't allowed to return, he decided to smuggle them back into the country by using the trade routes that his family used when they sold cloth. He hid the individual sheets of scripture in strips of cloth. In that way, he successfully smuggled in over 3,000 copies of the New Testament that were widely read and had a great impact on those that were able to read it. He then began work on the Old Testament and completed the translation of the first five books of the Old Testament. By that time, his adversaries were very angry with what he was doing, and so they devised a new plan to capture him. They hired a young man, whom I'll call Harry, to go to the country where Billy was in hiding. Harry's job was to befriend Billy and to set up an ambush to capture him. Billy was a trusting man, and so it was fairly easy for Harry to befriend him. They would meet regularly, they would talk about God's word, they would go on walks together. Once Harry was convinced that Billy didn't suspect anything, he set up an ambush along a narrow portion of their walking path. As they went out for that walk that day, Harry allowed Billy to lead the way into that narrow part. And as Billy entered that area, he realized that his way of escape from the one side was blocked by the one people, and then Harry was blocking his other escape. And so Billy had no choice but to surrender. He was captured and put in prison. After a year in jail, he was tried and he was convicted of taboo breaking, and he was sentenced to be hanged and then burned. Billy's last words before his death were a prayer to God for the chief of his people. And he cried out, "Lord, open the King of England's eyes." Billy's prayer was answered about 75 years later, when a new king, King James, commissioned a translation of the Bible from the original languages of Hebrew and Greek into the vulgar language of English. He assembled 54 of the greatest biblical scholars in Great Britain at that time, and in 1611, the King James Version was completed. A review of what those scholars accomplished shows that almost 90% of the New Testament and 90% of the first five books of the Old Testament were directly taken from Billy's own translation from around 1534. Billy, who is better known as William Tyndale, never had the opportunity to see the impact of God's word on the people of England. However, in time, the English became known as the people of the book because of their focus on the Bible in the life of a Christian. Billy saw the value of God's word and was willing to lay down his life to make it available to his people group. Now let me share briefly the story of Tommy. Tommy had the word of God in English, his mother tongue, thanks to the work of Billy and many others. Tommy was a diplomat, he was a lawyer, he was an architect and a philosopher. Tommy studied the word of God, but he didn't let the whole of it impact who he was. He decided to pick and choose those parts that he would believe. Working with the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Tommy took a razor and glue, and he cut out the selections that he agreed with. This included many of Jesus' parables, his Sermon on the Mount, and a lot of other moral teachings that Jesus gave. What was excluded, though, were the supernatural events that are recorded in the Gospels and which demonstrate Jesus' deity. For instance, there's no mention of his virgin birth. There's a birth, but no mention of the supernatural nature of that birth. In the story from Jesus' childhood, where Jesus remains in Jerusalem after the Passover feast while his parents head home, when they finally meet up with him in the temple 3 days later, Tommy chose to exclude Christ's words when he said, "Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house?" Christ's baptism by John the Baptist is included, but there's no mention of the Spirit descending on him like a dove at his baptism. In the Bible, many of Christ's teachings are given in the context of a miracle. Tommy chose to include the teachings, but to exclude the miracles. There are 37 miracles of Jesus in the Gospel, but none of them are included in Tommy's cut-and-paste version. No healing of leprosy, no healing of the paralytic, no casting out of demons, no healing the deaf and the mute, no feeding of the 5,000, no healing of the man born blind, no raising Lazarus from the dead, and no resurrection of Jesus. Tommy's gospel ends as thus. Then they took the body of Jesus and wound it in linen cloths with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulcher, where never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, and rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher, and departed. That's how it ends. Compare that with the Apostles' Creed. It's small there, but I'll read it for you. I believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Tommy didn't want to live under the authority of God's word. He chose to live above it and to be a judge of it, choosing what he would believe and what he wouldn't believe. He didn't let the word of God shape him. Instead, he cut and pasted it to fit what he wanted to believe. Tommy was Thomas Jefferson, third president of the United States. His cut-up version of the gospel is known as the Jefferson Bible. His attitude toward the Word of God is the attitude of many today. They don't want to live under the authority of God's Word, but they want to live over it, deciding what they are willing to believe. So I've shared a bit of my story, the story of Tommy and the story of Billy. And there's one story that's still being written. That's the story of Charlie. Charlie is the Muslim from the Kotoko people group, who's the mother tongue translator that I work with. When we moved to the language area in 1998, I held courses in French on language development, how to analyze a sound system, how to analyze the grammatical structure of a language, how to set up a writing system. And Charlie attended each of those courses and others. Together over the years, we've been working on translating God's word into his mother tongue. As I mentioned earlier, this year we'll be revising the Gospel of Luke, or at least portions of it. I'd ask you to pray for Charlie, that he would see the value of God's word in his mother tongue and allow it to transform him so he can be like Billy and not like Tommy, one who recognizes the value of the word of God as opposed to choosing what he wants to believe and not to believe. Let me conclude with today's scripture passage from 2 Timothy 3. I'll read the first five verses and then from 10 to 17. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And then down to verse 10. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, sufferings, what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. And from infancy, you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Let me just close in prayer. While I do that, if the musicians want to make their way. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its transforming power, how it can shape our minds, how it can shape our hearts, our emotions, how it can transform our lives and lead us in directions that you would have us go. We know, Lord, that you are the creator of the universe and you are the creator of each of us. And you have created us each with a purpose. And it is when we submit ourselves to you and to your word that we are able to fulfill that purpose that you have for us in this world. We pray, Lord, that you would encourage us through this coming week to share your word through love. In Christ's name, amen.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. They give us strength, help us go in this world. Wherever we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. Sound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient
share a benediction with you in closing from Ephesians 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.
Hello again. Thank you for tuning in to St. Andrew's online worship service today. Subscribe, share, like, or leave a comment or question below and we'll get back to you. Firstly, I would like to thank everyone who came out for the spring cleaning. You're awesome. We got many items checked off the list and we could not have done it without you. June is gearing up to be a busy month. On Sunday, June the 12th, we'll bid a fond farewell to Helen and Gary Coombs. They've sold their house in Toronto and will be moving soon. Friday, June 17th, we'll have a picnic in the parking lot with hot dogs, veggie dogs, chips and drinks for all of St. Andrews from 4:30 till 6:30 p.m. And we hope to see you there. Sunday, June 19th, we'll hold our congregational meeting after the service to determine the budget for the next year. If you consider St. Andrews your home church, I would encourage you to attend the meeting to have a voice in the conversation and decisions. We look forward to seeing you there. The link for the Zoom connection will be in the weekly email. And of course, Reverend Steve Lindsay will be our 100th anniversary speaker on June 26th. Now here are a few words from Maurice McWinney, the stewardship team leader.
I'd like to also thank you for your donations and contributions. We've been having a tough time. As some of you may know, or may not know, but maybe you're going to hear it now, that we're going through a difficult time financially within the congregation, with a significant deficit projected for the current year, the year ended June 30th, 2022. Fortunately, we had a surplus last year, and we had additional grants, federal grants, we received this year that hopefully we will end up the year with some cash in the bank. We want to thank all those faithful donors who have given offerings over the last couple of years during the pandemic when we were not here in person. Offerings can be received through the offering plate at the back or through electronic transfers. Some people put it through or mail it in to Jackie at the office. Some people put it through the mailbox and it gets collected and deposited. But one thing I'm going to ask or tell you about, some people may or may not know, is a thing called PAR or PAD, pre-authorized donations. If anyone is interested in that, it's a system whereby that you sign up and on the 20th of every month, your donation is taken out of your bank account and put into the church's bank account. The cost of that is very, very minimal, 50 cents per transaction in a month. So with some of the electronic fund transfers, it can be a lot more, but 50 cents, and it doesn't matter how much you contribute, it comes out automatically, goes into, the net amount goes into the church. You can also specify which fund you want it to go to, general fund, Presbyterian sharing, mission, wherever you want it to go, you specify on the fund or on the sheet as well. So if anyone is interested in that, you can either please see Jackie or myself and we can explain further about the information on the pre-authorized donations.
Thank you for your continued financial offerings, which support the life and work of St. Andrews by check, by hitting the donate button on the website, through e-transfers to office@standrewsislington.org, or by the pre-authorized remittance. If you are interested in using offering envelopes or the pre-authorized donation program, contact me at the office at 416-233-9800. See you next time.